Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the second meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I have not received any apologies for today's meeting. And the first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take item 5 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. I should say the convener has, of course, given apologies, given that I am convening the meeting as deputy convener. So we'll note that. And we're agreed to take item 5 in private. The next item on our agenda is an oral evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care on three public petitions, which are PE1845, PE1890 and PE1924. The petitions all relate to rural healthcare. And I welcome to committee this morning Hamza Yousaf, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, Susan Gallagher, the Deputy Director, Primary Care Strategy and Capability, Sir Lewis Ritchie, Professional Advisor, and Dr Gregor Smith, the Chief Medical Officer, all from the Scottish Government. The Cabinet Secretary will make an opening statement and then we'll move to questions. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you so much, Convener, and thank you for being so accommodating with my time. I'm grateful for the committee shifting this to slightly later to help me with some childcare issues I was having, so I'm very grateful for you being so accommodating to me. I'm also grateful for the opportunity to be here today to respond to the committee on questions relating to the public petitions that will be discussed today. Let me begin perhaps once again, as I did last week, by restating and reiterating the fact that we are currently experiencing extreme pressures within our health service. This is, I think, by any estimation, and has been the most challenging winter that the NHS right across Scotland and indeed across the UK that we've ever faced. Our NHS and its committed workforce is facing a perfect storm of intense pressures, which are leading to difficulty, they're leading to disruption and delay right across the service, including, of course, in remote and rural communities who often face their own significant challenges, and many of them, I suspect, we will touch upon in the course of today's discussion. As I outlined in Parliament last week, we've clearly advised health boards to exercise their own judgment in relation to their own localities and what action is necessary to overcome, or at least mitigate, some of the challenges they're experiencing. I'm absolutely aware, as I say, of the challenges facing rural Scotland when it comes to healthcare, having visited all of our boards, but spent a significant amount of time in our health boards that have remote, rural and indeed island communities within them. I'm determined to ensure our remote and rural areas are not left behind as we continue to invest and reform our health and social care systems. Convener, I expect NHS boards that serve remote and rural settings to take account of the particular needs of their communities, ensuring services are developed in a flexible and an innovative way, recognising local population concerns and, of course, those significant geographical challenges. A blanket approach for a country as geographically diverse as ours is simply not appropriate. Convener, frontline workers are, of course, the absolute foundation of our health and social care services. We've committed to growing that foundation, and overall staffing levels have increased by almost 3,000 permanent whole-time equivalent roles in the last year. That builds on our strong track record of delivering 10 years of consecutive growth, almost 30,000 additional whole-time equivalent staff working in NHS Scotland compared to 2006, around about 28,000. 900. We're making nearly £8 million of funding available to boards to support the recruitment of up to 750 nurses, midwives and AHPs from overseas this winter. This will, of course, include boards with remote and rural localities. We're creating opportunities for an initial 250 Band 4 assistant practitioners across acute, primary care and mental health, and we continue to expand the number of trainee doctor posts in line with medical workforce modelling. 725 additional training posts have been created since 2014, including 152 which are recently agreed and will be recruited in 2023. And we know the importance, and again, I'm certain the committee will discuss this, the importance of training posts being available in remote and rural health boards. I recognise that GPs in remote and rural areas also, of course, have very distinct challenges. That's why we've invested £7 million of funding since 2019 to take forward a range of initiatives to support rural general practice, which includes support for recruitment and retention. This includes a Golden Hello scheme to attract new rural GPs, a £20,000 bursary to recruit and retain GPs, GP trainees in hard-to-fill locations, and of course, Scotland's first graduate entry medical programme, ScotGem, provides a graduate entry medical degree with a rural focus, and a pilot scheme to recruit experienced GPs to provide support to rural practices. So far, this programme has seen 52 students graduating. And in fact, I think the CMO was at that graduation, allowing them to progress to foundation year one posts. We're also supporting a recruitment campaign. Many committee members will have heard of it, Rediscover the Joy, which aims to recruit experienced GPs to provide support for remote and rural practices. And as we go into committee, I'm happy to give some of the detail of how that particular programme has assisted. NHS Education Scotland has also developed a credential in remote and rural healthcare for doctors that recognises the very unique skills required to work in these challenging regions and provides a route for upskilling in these environments. We're working very closely with NHS Education Scotland to scope a national centre for excellence for remote and rural health and social care. Again, a piece of work Sir Lewis Ritchie was absolutely not just involved in, but leading. And I'm grateful for all of the work done in this regard. It will have an initial focus on primary care, but clearly I imagine it will be of interest to those right across health and social care. The centre will be a resource that boards and health and social care partnerships will be able to utilise in support of their responsibilities for providing rural health and social care. Our aim is the centre will identify, celebrate, but importantly pull together the many examples of innovative work already going on and promote excellence to address those long-standing issues, particularly in relation to recruitment and retention in remote and rural areas. We remain committed to growing our nursing workforce in remote and rural areas and look forward to welcoming new pre-registration nurses to the University of Highlands and Islands in 23-24 academic year. Since the programme was established in 2017, we've seen a fantastic increase of 34% on the intake. So while we're committed to investing and reforming the NHS and social care systems nationally, we're fully aware of the challenges of rural healthcare and we're responding to them. Convener, women's health is a key priority for this government, which is why Scotland was the first country in the UK to publish a women's health plan in August 2021. Our ambition is for Scotland, is for a Scotland where health outcomes are equitable across the population so that all women, regardless of where they live, enjoy the best possible health throughout their lives. There has been some substantial progress since the publication of the Women's Health Plan. There's now a specialist menopause service in every mainland health board and a buddy support system in place for those island health boards. We've initiated new research on endometriosis, launched a new women's health platform on NHS Inform, and we've increased access to bridging contraception in community pharmacies. But, of course, there's still much to do. I hope these are important, welcomed first steps. While a formal review of NHS Highlands Gynecological Services is underway, the board has set up additional capacity for both outpatient and theatre treatment. This will provide much-needed capacity across Caithness General Hospital, Belford General Hospital, Lawson Memorial Hospital, and Ragmore Hospital. In conclusion, Convener, I'd like to thank our exceptional health and social care staff who make such an incredible contribution to keeping us safe, especially under the current challenging conditions and especially where those challenges can be exacerbated by remote and rural geography. Convener, I'm grateful also to the petitioners for taking the time to bring these petitions to our Parliament. Of course, I'm happy to take questions on these matters and any others that you wish to ask this morning.
Thank you very much. I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for his opening statement, helping to, I think, set the scene for many of our questions. I think I'll begin this morning just with a couple of broad questions, and then we'll move to colleagues as we go along. You know, obviously, the petitioners have outlined the various challenges that exist in terms of geography, access to services, availability of staff, and much of that you have touched on, Cabinet Secretary. I suppose if we think about the wider structural challenges challenges within how the NHS is set up and operates in many of these communities. I wonder if there has been any thinking about structures, about how the NHS operates at board level in many of these communities. Do we need to look at, for example, how those boards operate? Do we need to look at devolving more power down into local communities? Has there been conversations around that? Because obviously a lot of what the petitioners have asked for is a lot of that decision-making perhaps to be more localised as well. So I don't know if there's a comment you want to make on that.
I mean, I think it's an excellent question, and that, I'll often go to a remote and rural health board, and let's just take an example, the one that probably covers the largest geographical area, so take NHS Highland. And of course, as you know, convener, that also covers a Gyllene Butte, as well as North Highland. And, I will often go to either North Highland or a Gyllene Butte, and they will say, well, the challenge is here. There may be some similarities with what other parts of NHS Highland are facing, but we also have very, very unique challenges in our Gyllene Butte, and particularly the islands, for example, that they have within their geography. So absolutely a conversation about devolving further, and that's why when I visited, let's just take Chat, for example, the campaign group around Caithness Hospital, it was very clear to me that they felt, came across very strongly, there was a disconnect between the community in Caithness and what they were saying was coming from the health board management level. That was a message that they communicated to me, and obviously I took back to the board, and now I'm pleased to say that there's regular meetings that are scheduled in diary between Chat, that particular campaign group, and the health board. What I'm so absolutely, as far as our health boards absolutely can devolve some of that, if it's not direct decision making, certainly really important to have that engagement at a local level. That is important actually, both in, for urban, but I would say even more important for remote rural island health boards. Where I would perhaps draw the line at this stage is that we're not looking at wholesale structural review of health boards. I just think, given all the other pressures that we're facing, we're not talking about breaking up health boards into smaller health boards, certainly not at this stage. We have the structure in place that we have at the moment. I think disrupting that in its entirety at this stage is probably would take a lot of focus away from the significant challenges we're facing. All of that being said, of course, we have the NCS bill going through Parliament, and I know every member around this committee table knows that healthcare and social care are so integrated, and therefore there's certainly a conversation to be had about the interaction between health and social care with the current system, but certainly with a view to a national care service coming into to play too.
Thank you very much. I wonder if I could move on to a question around something you referenced, which is the National Centre for Remote and Rural Healthcare and the work that's been done on that. I suppose we'd be keen, I think, as a committee, to understand how is success going to be measured in terms of that innovation? And I think it would be useful to have an update, if we can, on its development and where we are in terms of the progress with that. And perhaps Sir Lewis may want to comment as well, but I'll come to Cabinet Secretary first.
Yeah, I'll bring Sir Lewis shortly. And it's a good question, because essentially what we're asking the Centre for Excellence to do is, we know that there's multiple good pieces of innovation going across a number of health boards in remote and rural Scotland, and actually pulling together that work and doing that work more collaboratively might bring better return for those health boards. And having the centre almost having that multiplying effect on that innovation and those innovation practices across remote and rural Scotland could be really helpful. So as I say, Sir Lewis might be able to talk more about, because he was deeply involved in the genesis and the idea of a centre for excellence. But I think, sharing effective practice, sharing data, sharing that evidence, supporting boards to deliver a stronger collaborative response response to some of these concerns, which, you know, by and far the biggest concern I hear from health boards in remote and rural locations is workforce, is recruitment and retention, which tends to be the biggest challenge. So I think the Centre for Excellence can absolutely help in that regard. Where are we? NES, National Education Scotland, have agreed to host, be the host for the centre. I think that makes sense, given, again, their remit around education, around training, etc. Makes a kind of natural fit for them. I suppose the big question is about funding. That's an understandable question. And as you know, convener, we're very much in discussions around the 23-24 budget. So I'll not preempt the conclusion of that budgetary process, but I've asked for a proposal for how much the centre would require in 23-24 in order to make progress. And I'm still waiting for that information, obviously, to come back from NES, but I would expect it very, very shortly, and I'll obviously consider that with an open mind. But if you don't mind, I'll maybe pass to Sir Lewis, who's, as I say, been deeply involved in the centre.
Certainly, Sir Lewis.
Aye, thank you, Cabinet Secretary and Convener. And I think I might frame my initial response in Cabinet Secretary mentioned the enormity of the challenges in remote and rural areas, and I'm reminded, of course, that whereas 70% of the Scottish population stay in remote and rural areas, the landmass of that is about 98% of Scotland. And that brings unique challenges, clearly, to service delivery, both the retention and the recruitment of staff, and the fulfilment of equitable care across Scotland. So the centre was born out of one of 12 recommendations that we made to the Scottish Government in relation to how to improve the delivery of the 2018 GP contract in remote and rural areas. And that looked at the future of contractual arrangements and how they could be modified for the better going forward. It looked at recruitment and retention. It looked at infrastructure, which clearly is important, both physical infrastructure and also delivery infrastructure. One of our recommendations in that regard was there is considerable scope for digital innovation going forward. As to the centre itself, I would use three summary words, if I may. One is the centre should be a centre of excellence for education. It should be a centre of excellence for innovation and also evaluation. Too often in the past, we have implemented models in not only remote and rural areas, of course, but across Scotland, where we have not done the due diligence of evaluating the benefits and the costs of these models. If we get this centre in its best position, I would expect this centre not only to benefit remote and rural communities within Scotland, but also for it to have an international profile so that others can learn from us and the good things we do in Scotland.
Thank you. There are some supplementary questions, firstly from Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Convener. I heard a lot about recruitment retention, about staff, and these are all very important when it comes to our rural areas. But what I would like to know directly is the impact of the £65 million cut to GP budget and how that's affecting primary care in rural areas, which is already struggling more than in the central belt.
So again, I mean, difficult to evaluate because we're obviously in the midst of the current financial year, but Dr. Gohani will know that we took a very difficult decision in the EBR, largely down to UK government's mismanagement of the economy, meaning that my budget was worth £650 million less than when it was set last December. Obviously, on top of that, we have put forward a record pay deal, 7.5%. Which is far greater than any other country in the UK has put forward for its NHS staff, and obviously means that Scotland currently is the only country not experiencing nursing or indeed any NHS strikes this winter. So really difficult decisions we had to make, some of that because of decisions we've taken around the workforce, some of that because of, as I say, mismanagement of the economy. So that means £400 million having to be reprofiled. No easy decisions in that. mental health, primary care, social care. These are not areas that any health secretary, I suspect, in the world looks to try to make savings from. So the impact and the full impact of those savings, whether it's in primary care, social care, mental health, will only be realised, I suspect, as we get towards the end of the very end of the financial year. But fair to say, we've been working closely with our GP services to see what we can do, not just GP services, everybody in primary care, to see what we can do to try to mitigate the impact. I suspect one of the biggest areas of concern, and this was highlighted by the BMA in their response to that reprofiling of funds, was around the sustainability funding. And what I'm keen to try to do this next financial year in the 23-24 is ensure that we don't lose focus of the increase we've seen in multidisciplinary team staffing, which has helped in all GP practices, whether you're urban or rural, but I think there's been a significant benefit for remote rural GP practices in relation to spreading that workload where it's a bit more difficult to recruit and retain GPs, being able to recruit more of the multidisciplinary staffing, the advanced nurse practitioners, the physios, etc., the pharmacists, all of that can make a significant difference. But I'm not going to sit here and pretend to you that a cut in primary care of the scale that we've made won't have an impact. It's just about evaluating some of that impact, but ensuring that we mitigate it as best we possibly can in 23-24.
And so with that answer, I think we're also missing the fact that vacancies are on an upward trend. And if we look at the AHP vacancies, for example, 1,252 whole-time equivalents are required. You look at medical and dental, 392 whole-time equivalents are required. Nursing midwifery, 6,319 whole-time equivalents are required. And this is an upward trend that happened before the cuts. So my real concern here is that we are going to see rural and deprived areas really struggle when it comes to their primary care services. And this is something that is going to affect them more than it will people in the Central Belt, and I'm not hearing a solution to help.
Well, let me try to give you a few solutions if I can. And Dr. Khan is right. Workforce and recruitment plus retention of that workforce is exceptionally important. So, a few things that we're trying to do. First and foremost, we have a good record on recruitment and staffing. I referenced some of that and my opening statement, but I'm not in disagreement with Sandesh Gohani that the vacancies are far too high. I look at nursing and midwifery, I look at the AHPs, whatever the vacancy rate is, but particularly around nursing and midwifery, that is far too high. And so we've got to work to try to resolve that. I've often said in the parliamentary chamber, we've got to look at recruitment and retention, although interlinked, is actually look at them as separate work streams. There's no point filling the leaky bucket. So our recruitment record is good. We've got to make sure our retention record is just as good. And we start, as I say, from a strong position. You know, that 28,900 almost increase in staffing since 2006, more GPs than head than anywhere else in the UK, higher nurses per head than other parts of the UK. What are we trying to do about it? You've talked about solutions. Well, I always think about recruitment, and I'll come to retention shortly, as having a three-pronged approach. One is the pipeline. So we're making sure that our pipeline of graduates coming through the system is going to match what our demand is for the future. And we've made, for example, in the medical workforce, we've made commitments and fulfilling those commitments to increase them 100 per annum over the course of the parliamentary term. So 500 by the end of the parliamentary term, and so far, not just meeting but exceeding that target. 10 consecutive years of growth that I mentioned in terms of the numbers. So pipeline is one. The domestic recruitment, and by domestic I mean right across the UK, so we have a very proactive campaign underway to try to recruit GPs, particularly with a campaign focus on remote and rural Scotland from other parts of the UK. I make no apologies for that. I think Scotland's a very attractive place. I think remote and rural parts of Scotland are very attractive places to work in Scotland. And the third is that international recruitment piece. So again, you know, ask about solutions. There's £8 million to try to recruit 750 nurses, midwives and EHPs. Not the panacea. I'll sit here and suggest to you that international recruitment is going to resolve all of the challenges we face around workforce. But I think as part of that three-pronged strategy, it can make a difference. And certainly in my engagement with the remote and rural health boards, they believe that the international recruitment piece is one that we can absolutely get more advantage than we're currently getting, particularly in remote rural areas. And then the retention piece is a lot we are doing, can do. So I attended a nursing roundtable with the RCN. I think a couple of members around this table, Gillian Mackay certainly was there, a few members around this table were there. And Gillian Mackay will remember that one of the comments coming from the RCA and from a nurse there was around, you know, retiring and you know, being rehired, and the inflexibility that existed meant that she was just going to leave the health service altogether, which was a huge loss because I think she had well over three decades of experience. So that was fed back to the chief nursing officer, who I'm glad, working with the RCN and others, has got an updated retire and return policy in place, and it's been welcomed by much of the workforce. The REC scheme, again, this was a direct call from another trade union or professional body, the BME, who'd been calling for a recycling employer contribution scheme to be brought forward to deal with some of the tax disincentives, pensions disincentives, sorry, that are existing in the system. And the REC scheme was very much in our gift, so we've devolved that to health boards, and REC schemes have gone live in health boards across the country since the end of December. Obviously, there's more that can be done on pensions, and I welcome what the UK government has done thus far, but the call from the BMA is for them to go even further, and we'd support that call. So, I mean, I could speak, I think I've taken a fair bit of time on that answer right enough, but I could speak to more that we're doing on the recruitment retention side, and much of it geared towards helping our remote and rural health boards.
Thank you. Emma?
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everybody. Cabinet Secretaries will be aware that I've written to him on a few occasions about specific issues in remote and rural Dumfries and Galloway, like Stranraer, and I really appreciate your responses, so thank you, and thanks for being here today, everybody. I'm interested in the Centre of Excellence for Remote and Rural Health and Social Care. Sir Lewis, you talked about it being education, innovation and obviously collaboration. But I'm interested in if there will be a role to help advocate for people who are in remote and rural areas, because those folk can't access the self-help groups, the people that are in urban, more urban areas. And I know people are engaging using Zoom and all of that to engage as well now. So is there a role for or a place in this agency where advocacy can be supported or delivered? And I know that you know, in Australia they have a rural commissioner for health as well. So I'm interested in that kind of aspects of the Centre for Excellence.
Thank you. If I may just reflect back on a comment that the Cabinet Secretary made earlier about Rediscover the Joy, which is a scheme that actually has been able to promote 65 vacancies temporarily being filled in Scotland by GPs. I just wanted to flag that in the passing. As far as the centre is concerned, the exact nature of the centre is still being scoped out, and that's been done by NHS Education Scotland. My own personal view is that the centre would not have a particular advocacy role. It would be involved in educational development, as you said earlier, in innovation and evaluation. That would be its prime concern. You also mentioned the Rural Health Commissioner in Australia, which I flagged to the Petitions Committee as part of my response and written evidence when they asked about my views about the petition they were considering. And that post was established in 2017, and the first commissioner published a report in 2020, and the particular role that health commissioner has is one of advocacy in relation to service development and in relation to educational development as well. So in terms of advocacy, a rural health commissioner, if considered, might be a post, an office that might be able to advocate for remote and rural matters.
Yeah, I'm happy to add to that, to say that the government's in agreement with the position that probably wouldn't have, the Centre of Excellence probably wouldn't have an advocacy role given, you know, sits with NAES and what we are, what the original thinking behind the centre has been. I don't think it would quite fit into that advocacy role. In terms of Rural Health Commission, I think it's an idea that's worthy of merit. We've obviously been focused on what the centre's core purpose will be as opposed to consideration of a Rural Health Commissioner. But I think the idea, as Sir Lewis has already said, which you can see in a number of other countries, is certainly worthy of worthy of merit and consideration, but the first and primary focus has to be getting the Centre for Excellence established and up and running.
Thanks. I'm thinking about advocacy role just because for more than 20 years now we've been trying to look at cancer pathways in Stranraer, for instance. Mm. People go and get the radiotherapy. In Edinburgh, it's 140 miles compared to 87.2 to go to Glasgow. So if we're looking at helping support people to get their care closer to home, I realise that the South East Cancer Network is where the people in Dumfries and Galloway go, but nowhere in Dumfries and Galloway is in the South East of Scotland. So I'm thinking, how would we have opportunities to look at relocating the service for cancer pathways for people in Stranraer, for instance, to go to Glasgow instead of the 140 miles to Edinburgh?
So yeah, and it's a valid question that I know you've raised before. Forgive me, I don't have the most up-to-date position, but I can see entirely the logic that Emma Harper is deploying in relation to Stranraer and it feeling like it would make far more sense to be part of the West of Scotland cancer pathway. If Emma Harper doesn't mind, what I'll do is I'll take a look at the latest position, because I had raised it with the health boards involved, and I remember the response at the time being that that many patients could travel to Glasgow, but if that's clearly not from Stranraer, but if that clearly is not happening and not the experience, then I want to find out why. So if Emma Harper's okay on that specific point, I'll come back to her, perhaps through the convener, to Emma Harper in writing. On the more general point, as I say, the issue of a commissioner is worthy of exploration. I think the difficulty would be, given just the volume of correspondence I get in my inbox, I think it'd be very difficult, even if we were to establish a commissioner, the expectation of that commissioner to then have to advocate for every single patient with every single challenge or issue that they have with the health service. We have obviously patient rights embedded within statute and guidance. We also have very, I would say, robust procedures in place to deal with complaints, etc., etc. But yes, I think we just probably just need to take a bit of time before we consider any further, you know, commissioner or advocacy individual who will advocate, or indeed an organisation that maybe will advocate on patients' behalf.
And I know that Jean Freeman, as CABSEC, has done work on this, and basically ensuring that the people are offered a choice, because they might want to go to Edinburgh for radiotherapy if they've got family in Edinburgh and they can stay overnight with them. But choice is what Jean Freeman, as CABSEC, was advocating for at that point as well. So it's just ongoing challenges in how to support patients and manage expectations as well, because I understand that sometimes people have to go to other centres that will deliver radiotherapy, for instance, because there isn't the ability to do that in the new hospital in Dumfries. So I would appreciate, yes, some further follow-up. So thank you.
Yeah, no, I'll get you the latest position. And of course, choice is only good if people are actually offered choice. So yeah, I'll get you the latest position.
Thank you. That's very helpful. We're going to move on to questions on the wider involvement of service users from Carol Malkin.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, thanks for coming along today. I'm very interested to just explore the experiences of people in remote and rural areas and how they interact with services. And this government often repeats its commitment and its engagement of service users and people with lived experience. There is a sense from the petition and also from other sort of action groups that that doesn't happen particularly well. And I wondered if the Cabinet Secretary could just speak a little bit about how he feels that is going. I know there is a responsibility on us to do that. Health Improvement Scotland monitors that. But just how you feel in remote and rural areas and in relation to this petition, how you feel that engagement has gone.
So, I mean, look, I am always of the opinion that you can never have too much engagement. Engagement is positive, and visibility is positive, and it can be tricky. I know, for example, myself, I've had to, for example, last week cancel a meeting with the fantastic Women's Hub in North Highland, and much to their annoyance, understandably so, because of the certain pressures of the parliamentary schedule that I had last week. Now, so there will always come be times when that engagement can end up being disrupted for understandable reasons. But what I think frustrates me slightly, and I'll not mention any health board because I think it's an issue that all health boards need to be cognizant of, is they can often feel like there's a disconnect between the health board management and health services and health provision locally on the ground. And what my instruction to all of the health board chairs and chief executives is one for them to be visible, and all the management, the board, to be senior management, to be visible. But secondly, to ensure that engagement is happening on a regular basis, and not just engagement, but what can we do to make people not just feel like they're being heard, but what proactive action can be taken in order to show and demonstrate that we're listening. We're not going to be able to do everything everybody wants. That's just the nature of what we deal with. But I would say the engagement has gone well, and I would, but there's certainly more to do, and I would encourage boards to also make the best use of technology. I know it's not always possible to travel around the vast expanse of NHS Highland, for example, but there's many others, NHS Orkney, Shetlands, many islands there. Not always possible to get everywhere all of the time, but certainly making the best use of technology, I think, would be is certainly one of my instructions.
Yeah, I was going to come in this point because I think that there are signs of some areas who are beginning to do this really well. And if I take the example of the recent opening of the community hospital in Aviemore and the community engagement that's at round about that, the involvement of the community both in the planning of how that would work, the services that would operate from it, and continued thereafter with the kind of service providers who operate from that, it then becomes almost a kind of what we would refer to as an anchor institution within that community, as a place where people can begin to coalesce, discuss their ideas and look for that wider, how you begin to involve wider community engagement. I think that's a model for the future that we need to begin to exploit more and more, particularly as we're bringing on some of these wonderful capital projects and begin to kind of really have that act as the fulcrum for that engagement that you're speaking about. And as I say, Aviemore is a very good example of how that's gone about.
Thank you. Can I have one?
Of course.
Thank you. I think it's only fair to ask directly about the petitioner's request for an agency in terms of engagement with service users, just to find out exactly what the Cabinet Secretary's view on that is. I was very interested in the discussion that we had with Emma Harper on the Rural Commissioner, obviously, which may have some, maybe useful to discuss with the petitioners as well. But just, what is your view on that sort of agency?
Yeah, and I'll let Sir Lewis come back, as he was indicating a moment ago. So one thing, like everybody around this table, the creation of agencies, new organisations, institutions is not something we do lightly, partly because we don't want to clutter a landscape that you could argue already has a fair bit of bureaucracy around it. But secondly, there's obviously financial resource implications, which you have to be very alive and alert to, which we all are, particularly given current pressures. So I'm very invested and committed to the Centre for Excellence, which we've spoken about already. I think that can help us with some of the real challenges that we're seeing in remote and rural Scotland. Advocacy, as I've already said, I don't think it would have an advocacy role. I wouldn't intend at this stage to create an agency that advocates for patients, though I would say we've obviously committed to a variety of commissioners already in this parliamentary session, and she'll know the work we're doing around patient safety and patient safety commissioners in that respect. So I wouldn't at this stage, I know that will be a disappointment perhaps to the petitioners, I wouldn't at this stage be looking to create a new agency that particularly works around the advocacy piece. But I do think to help us with remote and rural healthcare, the Centre for Excellence can play a really critical role. But I'll maybe pass this to Lewis, who was indicating he wanted to come in.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, if I may come on the back of both the Cabinet Secretary and CMO's comments. I too am an advocate of public involvement in service provision. Those who receive services are entitled to shape them, in my view. In order to do that, you do need to consult and meet with those who you seek to shape services. I've been privileged to do a number of reviews, and always as part of the process of these reviews, I would have had a number of meetings, both with those who provide the services, clinical colleagues and support colleagues who are sometimes lost sight of in that regard, but also the public as well. And I'm a firm believer in advocacy at patient level, individual patient and public level, but also in what I call and has been described as co-production, which is those who receive the service working with those who provide directly to make better services in localities across Scotland.
Thank you. We're going to move on now to further questions about accessibility of services and indeed regional and national planning. And Sandesh Gohani will lead on this section.
Thank you. I have a number of questions that I'd like to ask, but I just want to pick up on something that the Cabinet Secretary said to me earlier. You mentioned that your budget was worth £650 million less, and I know you've said this in the media and in chamber. Can I ask how you arrived at this figure, and also are you happy and confident it's correct?
Yes, it's given to me and provided to me by some of my financial experts and analysts that we have within the Scottish Government. And as I say, they'll look at what the inflation level was when the budget was first set and what it is at the time we made that statement. Obviously, inflation does fluctuate, but certainly this was figures arrived at when inflation was at its peak. But I'm happy to provide more detail to Dr. Gohani if he wishes, and we can give him the full analysis breakdown of that £650 million, which our budget is worth less. But yes, confident in the figure.
Thank you. And so, right, on to this. Have you ever personally driven the A96 between Elgin and Aberdeen?
Yes.
So I've done it as well, and I did it on a sunny day. But imagine this. It's winter, it's cold, and it's dark. Your pregnant partner's in the back, screaming, because it's time to go to hospital, because your baby is due. Is that a position we really want to be in, given that Dr. Gray's maternity, consultant led service, is no longer running? Is that safe? Because we have had many times been told that people have given birth in lay-bys.
Yeah, certainly not a situation I would want to find my wife in. And certainly I would not want to be in that situation myself if I was driving my wife and she was pregnant on the A96. And that's the same for, and I'm sure we'll touch on Caithness too, it would be the same for those in Caithness. And let's consider what the weather is like there just now and has been over the last few days. So I wouldn't like to be in that position. But for Dr. Gray's, it's important, and it's worth me saying at this stage, I don't think there's another local matter that I've spoken more about in the chamber in terms of ministerial statements or debates than Dr. Gray. So it gets rightly so significant attention from me as the Cabinet Secretary and rightly from the government. And I'll not rehearse the latest position. I think Sanders Graham may have been in the chamber in the last debate. If not, he will have certainly appraised himself of the latest position. And the safety of women and their unborn children has been at the centre of our thinking in relation to Dr. Gray's, because, of course, at the moment, we could not, in good conscience, have a consultant-led service tomorrow. Because if we said that, and we said women, all women in Elgin, all women in Moray should be able to give birth, should give birth in Dr. Gray's from tomorrow, from next month, from later this year, we would be putting women at serious harm and their unborn children at very, very serious harm. And part of that discussion can maybe be understood if we look at the issue of what Rafe Roberts in his report around Dr. Gray's, when he referenced it as low-risk electives. Now, I'm very aware I'm talking to a doctor, so I have far more clinical expertise than anybody around this committee table, I suspect. He and you will therefore be the first to understand that the term low-risk elective C-section, well, that can quickly turn into a high-risk elective C-section, potential for bleeding, hemorrhaging, and therefore needing blood transfusions and other such things. And the facilities at Dr. Gray's, for example, would not allow that to take place. So even what is termed a low-risk C-section, as it was in Rafe Roberts' report, actually it requires significant investment in the facilities and indeed the workforce. So we have a plan in place. As you know, NHS Grampian have recently come forward with a plan for the return of consultant-led maternity services sooner than was previously predicted. I know a number of people in the chamber had referenced a kind of 10-year timescale, 7-year timescale, but he'll know that the timescale brought forward by Grampian is far shorter than that, and by the end of the parliamentary, or just beyond the parliamentary term. So positive in that sense, but I wouldn't underestimate the challenge that it will take to get there, and that's why the workforce and recruitment and retention issues are going to be at the core of this. The investment in the actual capital infrastructure, it for me, is not the difficult part, is the recruitment and retention. So forgive me, it's a longer answer to a relatively short question, but I don't feel that at this stage, that if we were to instruct that all women in Moray should be giving birth in Dr. Gray's, that would be a safe position for the women or indeed their unborn children at this stage, given the challenges around the workforce and the facilities at the moment. The Chief Medical Officer maybe add to that, given his clinical expertise, if there's anything to add.
Yeah, I think I was just going to emphasise that final point there, which is about the assessment of the safety of the service just now that would be able to be provided in that way just now. And certainly I know from recent discussions I've had with the medical director and with others in Grampian during a recent visit there, their intention is certainly to move forward as quickly as possible with the plans, but their assessment in the environment of risk that we find ourselves in now when we practice medicine is that they could not offer a service which they would be content to be able to pass as in terms of their risk assessment.
And can I ask, so talk about accessibility of services. We unanimously passed the transvaginal mesh bill. What progress have we had when it comes to women who are in rural areas throughout the country, but you know, we're focusing on rural areas, that want to move and get their service from Glasgow, from somewhere else in the United Kingdom, or even from worldwide United States? Where are we with that process, and have women come through this now?
Yeah, so the member might be aware, we've got I'm sure who probably take part, we have a debate later on this afternoon, committee debate on the mesh issue, and it's focused on largely on hernia mesh, but I suspect it'll segue into the issue of transvaginal mesh, and I can give an update, fuller update, and if also the member wishes a kind of written update, I'm happy to provide that too. So he'll know that we now have the contracts in place, both in terms of the contracts for other providers in England, so the Spire Clinic and Dr. Hashim, as well as the overseas contract with Dr. Veronicus and the Missouri Clinic underway. We have, I've got to be really careful what I say here, because we don't want to get into the territory of patient identification, but I think it's fair to say that patients have travelled to those providers. I couldn't tell you locality, and it began for patient identification, etc., etc. I had a meeting with a number of women who've been affected by the transvaginal mesh issue, a number of them from remote areas, and they made the point of telling me that there was definitely things we could do to improve the service for them. So one woman, again, I'll not say which health board she was from, but it was from a remote rural health board, told me that she was perplexed that she was offered a 9 a.m. appointment in the complex mesh service in Glasgow. She was travelling many hundreds of miles and being offered a 9 a.m. appointment. To me, that made no sense either. Now, the health board, in some circumstances, is Sandesh Grahani will know, will pick up the cost for travel and so on, but that's only in certain circumstances. But why make somebody even go through that? They're willing to travel, but don't want to have to leave the house at 6 a.m. or whatever else to make sure they get to the appointment on time. So I fed that back to the complex mesh service in Glasgow and understand that that feedback is being taken on board. But clearly, going back to Carol Mawkin's point, I'll regularly engage with the women that have been affected by transvaginal mesh and some of the campaign groups, and if that is not actually being implemented on the ground, I'd be pretty concerned. So there's definitely tweaks we can make in that regard to support women affected in remote and rural health boards.
Thank you.
We come to supplementaries now, and there are a number, but I'll start with Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, since June of last year, I've tried repeatedly to ask the Scottish Government when a women's health champion will be appointed. The Minister for Women's Health and even the First Minister have deployed every delaying tactic in the book. It's just been kicked down the road, a can that's been kicked down the road. But the petition on the services in Caithness and Sutherland really does underscore why a women's health champion is so important to Scotland. So why isn't this a priority for the Scottish Government? And can you say today when an appointment will be made? Thank you.
Look, I would say to Tess White, we've tried to approach this issue, whether it's the First Minister, or whether it's Marie Todd, or indeed myself, with as much openness and honesty and transparency. I mean, I don't share her kind of cynical worldview, or certainly view of the government, that we've been trying to kick this down the long grass or kick the can and so on and so forth. This may well be her characterisation, but it's certainly not the approach we've taken. We've always said that we've wanted to get the right person appointed. So important, because we envisage this women's health champion being in place for a long period of time. We don't want to get the wrong person. And we understand also that the people who are, and you can imagine the calibre of the people who have applied for this position, are also people who have many other commitments. And so we've got to be absolutely sure that the one, they are able to provide the time necessary for what I think is an exceptionally important role. But also, you know, there's a discussion to be had about the time commitment involved and their other commitments. So everybody that's applied and everybody that we have interviewed for this role is somebody of incredible stature, incredibly busy and has other commitments. So we've just got to work around that so that they understand what our expectation and all of this in this regard would be. The second thing I would say is that the Women's Health Champion is absolutely important, but that doesn't hamper our progress in the Women's Health Plan. I could give you a whole range of initiatives that we've taken forward. So you'll know the Women's Health Plan had 66 actions to it. I could give you a range of actions we've already progressed. I think I've already referenced actually some of them in my contribution, but I could give you a list of, you know, a number of actions. I won't do so. Perhaps again, if you want that further information, I'm happy to write to you. So I don't think a Women's Health Champion hampers us from making progress, being able to make progress. And the very last point is the direct answer to your question. We'd be hopeful within the government of being able to make an announcement on the Women's Health Champion within weeks, as opposed to months, within weeks. And we're very, very close to it. As I say, there are just some I's that need dotted and some T's that need crossed with the right person. I think we've got an excellent Women's Health Champion, potentially, if we get this one over the line in place. But that would be the intention, to get it over the line in weeks as opposed to months.
Thank you.
Thank you. Brief supplementary from Emma Harper, and then I'll come to Gillian McKay.
Thank you. Thanks. Just a brief... It's related to Sanjesh Gulhani's questions about Keith Ness and Murray and Dr Gray, same issue, it's in Stranraer again.
Yeah.
I hate to just go back on about it, but women are delivering their babies at the side of the road. There's a real recruitment challenges for Dumfries and Galloway to find midwives as well, to have a midwife-led maternity unit at the Galloway Community Hospital. And I'm not advocating that we start doing emergency C-sections. As a former operating room nurse, I've been there. In a rush, taking babies out of people by crash section. So I'm not advocating we do that in Stranraer, for instance. But, and I know Marie Todd visited Stranraer in October last year to help engage with the local Galloway Community Hospital Action Group and then go to visit the hospital. So I know there are real challenges with midwifery-led units, and I'd be interested in it. The Cabinet Secretary doesn't have to respond, obviously, today, about an update on the work that's been taken forward with the NHS Dumfries and Galloway and maternity services being reinstated back at Stranraer.
Yeah, again, I can provide a written update to Emma Harper on that specific issue. What I would say is we're very, very alive and alert to the issue around midwives from remote and rural Scotland, and she'll know the at-distance course that we are now running. That came on the back of, obviously, engagement discussions with rural remote health boards. My understanding, and I was just trying to find the exact figure for Emma Harper, if I can, I think my understanding is that when we look at those the new students to the short midwifery programme that's running for a second year, it's at Edinburgh Napier University, allows students to fully qualify as midwives in just 20 months, so a really good course. We will look at the nurses, so the course from nurses to midwifery. The nurses from remote and rural health boards that are enrolled in the distance learning course was 47%, so almost half of the entire intake was from remote and rural health boards. It's now actually increased to almost two-thirds, 65%. So 65% of those students on the short and midwifery course come from remote and rural health boards, and that distance learning is obviously an advantage to them, so they can remain within their board. So there's a lot we're doing. That's just one example of what we're doing in relation to the nursing midwifery side of things. But on her specific point, let me get her a written update. Again, I'll come in via the convener in that respect.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Gillian.
Thanks, convener. Obviously, I think the Cabinet Secretary shares my view that we should be trying to deliver services as locally as possible, and given the Cabinet Secretary mentioned the Lawson Memorial Hospital, for example, in Golspie, it's not the newest building in the world, having had family members who have had stints in it. Brilliant facility, but how do we ensure that these buildings can keep up with the pace of technology that is being delivered in some of our bigger hospitals in the Central Belt, where appropriate, and how do we make sure that they are fit for services going forward?
Yeah, I'll concede it. So Lewis wanted to come in and indicated, so I'll let him come in just a second. I think it's fair to say in my session last week in front of committee, there was rightly a quite intense focus around the capital infrastructure. And I could point to investments we've made, and Dr. Gregor Smith just mentioned a couple of new hospitals we built and opened last year, which I was very pleased to be a part of. So there's absolutely a place and a role for, frankly speaking, colloquially speaking, kind of shiny new buildings that have, that communities will always welcome, and they're built to the best standard to accommodate the equipment, the technology, best access standards, etc., net zero ambitions, all of that. But clearly, there's a significant need for refurbishment of an NHS estate. And again, one of the, it might have been Tess White who referenced, I think last week, the significant refurbishment and backlog refurbishment that exists. So the government's committed to a significant investment in that refurbishment, and that's got to not just be our large acute sites, although many of them need that refurbishment, but also some of those local community facilities. Russell, if you were indicating you wanted to come in.
Right, thank you.
It's okay, yeah,
I was privileged to work in a community hospital for all my, or almost all my career in Peterhead, and I also did a review at one point about them to try and improve their potential. And that includes technical innovation. I do think it's probably time to have a look again at the utility of community hospitals in Scotland, particularly in relation to step down, step up rehabilitation, and obviously the care of those who are in the final stages of their life, end of life care. Mm. I think that's all very important. I think it's, we need to look at them again, I would suggest, not just about the infrastructure, but actually the role that they fulfil.
Great, thanks,
yeah. Camina. Thank you. I wonder if I could just jump in here slightly on that point that Sir Lewis makes. Many people recently, in the context of our social care challenges, have spoken about that issue, and indeed the potential of going back towards a cottage hospital model in certain areas, or looking at certainly the provision of step up and step down care in a more local sense. Is that something that you would be keen to see more of?
Again, I'll come to Solus shortly if he's got anything to add. So I've often been asked about a number of cottage hospitals where we had to unfortunately take staff from during the height of the pandemic, and they had to go to larger acute sites. And is there merit in bringing them back on stream to help us with the social care challenges that we face? And actually, this was an issue I raised with the chief officer in Dumfries and Galloway in particular. And her response to me was very, very interesting indeed. Which was the staff that they've taken from particular cottage hospitals, actually they're able to offer more hours of care to more people doing care at home. And therefore, instead of, and I'm just making up the numbers for the sake of illustration, but instead of being able to look after 10 people at a time, they were actually almost doubling that to 20 people that they were able to look after and provide care to, which is important, and of course provide that care to people in their homes. So, by the way, there's a real important role for, I think, cottage hospitals, and they play an enormously important role within our health and social care services. I think these decisions have to be made at a local level around where the balance of benefit is in terms of staffing, but also the care that those staff are able to provide. But I think both colleagues wish to come in. So,
Sir Lewis and then Dr. Smith.
I agree with that. I think we're looking at an amalgam or a panoply of services, and indeed hospital at home has emerged as a service which was not talked about or delivered much 10, 15 years ago, and now that's online in a way that it hasn't been in the past. The other point I would make is you don't need a new building to call it a community hospital. You could actually have dedicated beds within a nursing home where more advanced care is delivered than nursing home care as we understand it. So I think we need to think laterally about that and not just think in terms of buildings.
Dr. Smith?
So Sir Lewis has already made some of the points that I wanted to make here, but I do think it's important that we don't just simply revert to the models that we had of yesteryear and bring them back, because practice has moved on, very clearly moved on, and the ways that particularly multidisciplinary teams work together are very different now than even 20 years ago. And models such as hospital at home, which Sir Lewis mentioned, I think are a really important aspect of the future way that we deliver care across communities. So yes, there will always be a need, I think, for particularly in rural areas to have step up, step down beds, But I do think that the hospital at home model, working in particularly these multidisciplinary teams, where we blur the what is a very artificial edge, I think, between primary and secondary care, and have specialists working alongside community teams in that environment, is one for the future, which has an awful lot of benefits, both for the teams who are employed in them, but especially for the patients who are receiving the care.
Thank you. For those contributions. We're going to move on to questions now on the use of digital technology and questions from David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, to our witnesses. Digital technology, the pandemic heightened the use of digital technology. So what impact has the increase of the use of digital service had in remote rural areas? And I'm going to roll all my questions at one, come conscious of time, Cabinet Secretary. What are the potential benefits and risks of a reliance on digital services in rural areas?
So I would say the two, and again, happy for other colleagues coming. So I think obviously the pandemic necessitated some of not just the use, but the frankly explosion in some of the use of digital technology, and I think that's something we'd want to retain where it's possible. So often members will speak to me about some of the challenges that they may be facing that are articulated to them from their constituents around access to local GP services. I've always maintained that the GP access should continue to remain a hybrid model. I think absolutely people need to be seen face-to-face. They should absolutely be seen face-to-face. But I think it's no bad thing at all to embed that use of technology, video, telephone consultations. And again, he knows about the real growth in near me. So he'll know that we have a digital strategy, healthcare strategy. I'm sure he's seen it. I've often referenced it in the committee appearances. I commend that strategy to anybody. It talks about some of the forward thinking that we're doing in relation to the use of digital tech. If I just take a most recent example, it's a very small scale example, but an important one is the launch of the NHS 24 app over the course of this winter. It's a minimum viable product, but it will be one that will grow and evolve as time goes on, and it can be another tool that we have in the toolbox to try to ensure that people get the right care in the right place at the right time. So I mean, I could go on for ages about the importance of digital tech. Clearly can make a big difference in remote and rural healthcare. And again, I can give you numerous examples of how we're deploying digital technology in remote and rural health settings. And again, speaking to campaign groups, a number of them have told me that is significantly important to them. What I would say is that for anybody that needs to be seen face-to-face clinically, clearly the expectation would be that they would be seen face-to-face. And if that is not happening, then clearly I've got a concern if that is the case. What I would say on reliance of it, we're very, very cognizant of digital exclusion, and that's why within our strategy we clearly reference that. So we've got to make sure that there are alternatives available for those that are unable to connect digitally. Clearly, the number one priority for the government is to making sure everybody has appropriate connectivity right across the country, and while that investment's being made, just making sure that we have those alternatives to digital available.
So I think Sir Lewis might, or both colleagues want to come back in with the convener.
Sir Lewis.
Briefly, thank you. I think we should look at digital innovation, not just in terms of service delivery, which I think is imperative, and there are numerous examples. To quote one, the Skylab in Portree, for example, been looking at how best to deliver care nearer to whom. There is also the dimension of the learning environment. One of the things we do know about remote and rural, and going full circle back to our earlier discussion, we know that those who train and learn in rural and remote environments are more likely to stay there or return there to practice their disciplines. And I think, again, digital innovation will be an enabler for that as well.
Yeah.
So 2 points I would wish to make in this kind of area. Just now, the first is around about that inclusiveness of the use of digital, and the work, I think, particularly with Scottish Libraries, is really interesting here in how you begin to create networks that support people to be able to use digital technologies to engage with clinical and care services more readily. I think is one which is really promising. It's something that throughout the course of Realistic Medicine, we've worked with the Scottish Libraries and Information Committee to try to develop those links to be able to provide people with trusted sources of information in that context, so that they're able to participate in these type of consultations now using digital technology in a way which is much more productive for them. So that's the first thing I would say there. The second thing is, I guess we probably shouldn't lose sight of the professional-to-professional supports and benefits that digital technology brings as well. So some of that might be about education and learning, about how you participate in those type of online courses or meetings in a way where you are much more likely to feel, again, part of a community and less isolated, but also in the way that you seek professional advice. So again, during recent visit to Highland, I heard very clearly from GPs and from hospital consultants about the use of some of the professional to professional sources of information that they were now using around about particular individual patient episodes of care, so that they could share information, ask questions, all of which was contained within the patient record in a very safe way, and was able to then form an audit trail in the background there as well. These are advances in technology and the use of technology that I think are very much to the benefit of patients, and allow often referrals to be avoided because advice is sought in other ways.
Thank you.
I just wonder, around the use of public libraries, I wonder if Dr. Gregor Smith could give us more information on that, whether in another time in writing, because public libraries are community buildings that are well used and are usually central to communities, so I'd be really interested in actually hearing about that.
I would be delighted to let you know a little bit of the work that we've been doing with SLIC in relation to that, Realistic Medicine, the provision of, as I say, trusted advice for people, not just in rural communities, but right across Scotland.
I think the whole committee would appreciate that, Dr. Smith. Thank you. We'll now move to questions from Evelyn Tweed on capacity and resilience of services.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary and panel. How do winter pressures impact rural health boards differently to urban health boards? And you have touched on that, but can they be predicted and can we plan for them?
I mean, we always certainly do our best to do that. So we will plan for winter, essentially. As soon as we've got through one winter, we'll start the planning for the next winter. And, of course, the remote and rural challenges can be quite significant. So let's take two aspects that have been central to our planning for winter. And actually for even before winter, the extreme pressures we were facing in the NHS. And that's the whole systems approach we take to both the front door and back door of really busy acute sites. So on the front door, what we try to do is reduce attendances. And that's definitely having some purchase. We're definitely seeing that that's working, though we'll continue to see if we can reduce attendances even further. And that's by ensuring people get the right care at the right place at the right time. So getting the access to other services, NHS 24, pharmacy first, general practice, out of hours, etc., etc. Now that, clearly from a remote and rural perspective, can be more challenging because the nearest service might be further away from you. And therefore, if you don't have a car, or even if you have a car, frankly, it can be tricky. If you don't have a car, a couple of buses, so on, that can be more tricky. And therefore, you think, well, if I'm not able to get there, then perhaps the safest option is to go to, you know, A&E because you're extremely worried about your own condition or family member's condition. So that's one of the real challenges. So our colleagues in NHS health boards and remote and rural and island health boards in particular have been working really hard to try to make those services as accessible as possible. And some of that goes back to David Torrance's very good question on the use of digital, and of course NHS 24 being that service that anybody right across the country can get that clinical advice from. We've got a number of clinical supervisors who provide excellent advice via NHS 24. And the other is the back door. So we know, again, one of the reasons why we are facing such significant pressure this winter, and again, it was pressure that we're facing before winter as well. There's the high levels of occupancy and the high levels of delayed discharge in the system. And again, if I look at social care, which is so important, critical for us to be able to clinically discharge people who are clinically safe to be discharged, there's no doubt at all when I look at the landscape of social care that those in remote and rural areas who are social care providers, both care at home and care homes, are really struggling. Yeah, there's a whole range of reasons for that. Often fuel costs, energy costs will be higher in remote, rural and island settings. So again, our local health boards will work with those care providers, see if there's anything they can do to make adjustments, any additional support that they can give to assist with those particular challenges. So, to summarise, absolutely important and vital and critical that we look at the unique challenges that remote, rural and island Scotland face when it comes to winter challenges, and absolutely is the answer to our first question, which is are remote, rural, island partners involved in that winter planning? Absolutely, and of course they are. But I've just given her two examples, and many more I could give where there's very unique challenges that face particular geographies in Scotland that we're very alive to, alert to, and trying to assist during what is a really difficult winter indeed.
Are the long-term impacts of cancelling routine surgery understood? What are they, and how can they be avoided or mitigated?
Yeah, again, maybe pass to the CMO shortly to add his clinical expertise to the answer. But it's fair to say, yes, they are well understood. I think one of the most difficult decisions taken in the pandemic was to pause elective care. And there's no doubt that doing so, you know, somebody waiting on a waiting list is not benign. You know, people deteriorate and decondition. And that is undoubtedly one of the factors of why we see people, I think, presenting sicker and with higher acuity, because we'll have seen that deterioration and that deconditioning. And I speak regularly to particularly orthopaedic surgeons and the Scott Network, as they're known, and they will tell me often that that there's simply no doubt that given the difficult decisions, and I would say necessary decisions taken throughout the pandemic, that people on a waiting list, unfortunately, you know, particularly long waits, are deteriorating and deconditioning. It's why when I announced certain targets in the summer, it was with a focus to those long waits, because we know that those waiting excessively long for elective care, then there's no argument for me, they will come to harm. You know, my goodness, speaking to those that have, you know, suffer from chronic pain, you can really understand from their perspective just how detrimental that has been to them. So I'm not going to pretend otherwise. How do you mitigate it? And I should say, in the context of the winter pressures, Evelyn Teed will be very aware, there's three health boards that have taken a decision for time-limited pausing of elective care. I stress time-limited, because although these are local decisions, I've made it very clear to those health boards, you know, and they understand this, and there's certainly no argument from them at all, that clearly that measure should be in place for as little time as possible, given all the impacts that pausing elective care can certainly have. So it's one of the reasons also why we didn't move the entire NHS to emergency footing during the winter. I know there were some calls from some people for us to do that, and I can understand where those calls came from. Mm-hmm. But if we had moved the NHS to emergency footing as we did in the early days of the pandemic, then instead of three health boards pausing elective care, we would have had every single territorial health board, all 14 territorial health boards, pausing elective care potentially, if we'd made that decision as we did in the early days of the pandemic, and that would have had a severe impact to people right up and down the country. So forgive me again, it's a fairly longer answer to a relatively short question, but I hope that gives you an understanding. But maybe I bring in Dr. Smith.
So the first thing I think I would want to say is I agree with the Cabinet Secretary entirely when he says that the decisions to pause some of those elective programme during the particularly the height of the response to the pandemic were absolutely necessary, and we shouldn't forget just how stark the reality we were facing at that time is. But undoubtedly it does have a knock-on impact on people. And clinicians across the country are seeing the results of both that impact and ongoing impact that it has for people. Cabinet Secretary has already covered some of the elements of that in terms of deconditioning and deterioration in conditions. But it goes beyond just the elective programme. When people think of the work that was paused or displaced by the impact of the pandemic, it's not just about the surgical procedures that were lost during that time. But people responded differently to healthcare during that time as well. They didn't seek treatment just as readily for all sorts of complex reasons that we begin to understand. And treatment was displaced because of the sheer volume of infectious illness that there was that people dealt with. And I think that we will see the impact of that for some time yet. And in fact, we're already starting to see the impact of that coming through with some chronic disease management. And that all was foreseen, was anticipated, and is now being very starkly realised in terms of some of the outcomes that we're seeing with people's long-term conditions as well. If I could say one thing for the future, it would be that this is an opportunity for all of us to kind of redouble our efforts, our focus in a relentless manner to address some of the secondary prevention initiatives that we've had in the past, to make sure that not only are we re-galvanising our approach to secondary prevention, but also that we are ensuring that we don't leave anyone behind as well, is that we're making sure that some of those groups that often were harder to reach, is that we're finding the ways of reaching them much more effectively and being able to offer those type of approaches to them for the future as well.
Can I ask you, Dr. Smith, are people actually coming forward now? You said that during the pandemic, for various reasons, they didn't. Are they actually seeking the care that they need now?
Sorry, can we just in terms of the relevance to the rurality and to these petitions, Evelyn, is it in a rural context?
Yes.
Okay.
So across the country just now, we're certainly seeing that there's a return to people seeking help, but I don't think that at this moment in time, when you look at the activity levels that we're seeing in many areas, that they've not reached pre-pandemic levels at this stage just yet.
I'm very conscious of time. We've got a number of questions to get through, so I'm going to move straight into questions on workforce, starting with Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener. We know that we have an ageing population in Scotland, and we heard during our National Care Service visit to Dumfries and Galloway that they are seeing a higher number of people retiring there as well, which obviously increases pressure on certain areas of service. What work is underway to ensure that we're taking account in terms of workforce of this potential change of demographic, and particularly the potential skewing of demographic with people retiring to certain remote and rural locations?
Yeah, I've touched upon some of this, and I referenced the round table that we both attended in terms of the RCN. So I'll not reiterate everything I said about the retire and return policy, but I'm happy to provide detail to the convener, who can obviously share it with committee members. But that came directly as a result of hearing nurses in particular saying 20, 30, 40 years in the profession and now thinking of leaving because of the inflexibility being shown around the possibility of retire and return, and many of them wanting to just reduce their shifts, but again the inflexibility of the system not allowing them to do so. So that's one thing. I think the second thing I would say is probably the most obvious point, but I do think it's worth reiterating, that clearly one of the significant things we can do to try to retain our workforce is to reduce that workload pressure. All of us around this table have spoken to NHS staff, and again, whether it's the nursing or medical or midwifery or any staff, frankly, working within the NHS will always use the word relentless to me to describe the last almost 3 years. And I think, they often tell me, well, you know, and again, in a typical kind of NHS career in a hospital, you know, you would be, and this will be the same sort of in community and primary care as well as secondary care, that you'll gear yourself up for the winter. You'll know you'll have a really rough few months, and then the pressure will begin to ease, and then you'll gear yourself back up as you get towards winter. That hasn't happened for effectively 3 years, just relentless pressure. So certainly the work we're doing to try to reduce that workload pressure, and you know, notwithstanding how difficult the last few weeks have been, we'll begin to see, I think, touch all we can here, begin to see an easing of that pressure. It won't be easy, but an easing of the most extreme pressure we've seen throughout the winter. So what can we do to try to stabilise the service so it doesn't feel as relentless as it has in recent months and years? Pay, I think, is important. I don't think we can just kind of skirt over that. I think making sure people who work in our NHS and indeed social care are appropriately rewarded is really important. And so, again, I won't rehearse everything I've said, but we've got a fair pay offer on the table. Gillian Mackay will note that at the end of last week, we also came to an agreement with the three trade unions that were in dispute and had a strike mandate where they will pause that strike action. And we'll enter into negotiations on 23-24 this week. And pensions, I think, are really important too. So again, regularly comes up from the medical workforce, in particular around the disincentive around pensions. So again, I won't rehearse what I've said. There's some action we can take. There's some action the UK government has taken. Want them to go further as to the BMA. And in a rural setting, I think it's so important. It's important everywhere, but I think in a rural setting, the real big advantage I think rural settings have got is often that kind of work-life balance that attracts people to go to work there. But for retention purposes, we really have to work, and we are working cross-government, cross-portfolio to deal with the housing, the education, later life provision for people, and that's got to be part of a holistic package. So forgive me again, that's a probably longer answer, but I don't know if Sir Lewis, I think, maybe wanted to come in.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Just again, I agree with what you've said. I think careers used to be linear, but they're now more complex. And our workforce planning needs to recognise that. Equally, workforce at one point was perhaps thought to be getting the numbers right. Now, that is still important, but it's not the whole position. We now need to be very more proactive about supporting career development, because that in itself will help retention, because looking to the future, we are in very difficult circumstances right now, as the Cabinet Secretary has eloquently said, but looking to the future, we need to be much more alive to career development and recognising that individuals may wish to develop their skills in a different direction with seniority, according to the skills and expertise they've accrued over many years. So I think we need to look at this in a number of ways, the number of staff being just the start of that process.
Thank you. Do we take Dr. Smith?
And then?
Yeah, and then
one last point in this, and we haven't spoken about ScotGem and what it has offered in terms of the production of medical students, new doctors, who are much more likely to go into to work in a rural environment. Not only has it done that, though, but it's also galvanised the careers of the educators who are providing the education to those medical students and new doctors as well, because certainly in the discussions that I've had with the trainers, they've spoken about actually how much they're enjoying their careers, having now been able to participate in elements like that as well. And I think that speaks to Sir Lewis's point there about careers now are very complex, and you need something to sustain them.
I had the absolute privilege to visit some school nurses in Falkirk a few weeks ago, and it's incredible the amount of preventative work they do, and they are hugely passionate and innovative in what they do. In rural and remote areas, their work could be extremely important in terms of preventative health, given the potential impact of certain practitioners on keeping people well, resulting in less attendances at acute settings, and the importance of this, given some of the distances involved in remote and rural areas. What planning is underway to ensure that we have a diverse mix of recruitment ongoing, to ensure that we don't lose sight of some really important healthcare professionals like school nurses?
Yeah, I think it's a great question, and it's why so much of our focus has been on growing that multidisciplinary team staffing within general practice and beyond in terms of primary care and the health service, because our ultimate goal, of course, is to ensure that people get treatment as close to home, at home if possible, but as close to home as possible, and that's just as important, I would argue, even potentially more important in a remote rural setting, given the challenges to access access to larger health service, to secondary care. I think primary care and the focus on primary and community is exceptionally important in that regard. So a lot of our focus has been on that, growing that multidisciplinary team, grown them to over 3,220 in the last number of years. And I think where we can, on the preventative side, focus a lot on is absolutely investment in the allied health professionals. Clearly, if you get access to an allied health professional earlier, sooner, before, you know, your condition becomes a lot worse, mm-hmm. then there may be a lot of benefit from that from a preventative perspective. I'm also incredibly impressed, and have always been incredibly impressed at how much our advanced nurse practitioners mm-hmm. Can do as well. So again, embedding them within community facilities, again, primary care in particular, but community facilities, I think can really help us. But I just want to make this final point that I think Julie Mackay also makes on her question, which is, often with the health service, you are dealing with the immediate. So let's take the immediate pressures that are in front of us in terms of the winter pressures. What I'm very keen is that we never, as a government, lose sight of the real importance of the preventative agenda. And I'm focused on that regularly, as you can imagine. But we don't want, for example, the really difficult challenges of the pandemic, and we had to deal with those and give those priority. We don't want to lose any focus of the excellent preventative work we're doing around obesity, around mental health, around smoking cessation, alcohol and drugs, healthy living, etc., etc. So, again, Marie Todd leads on that as Minister, responsibility for public health, but you can imagine she's driving that forward at pace.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm conscious we have five colleagues who want to ask questions on the broad workforce, whether that be about recruitment, retention, accommodation or training. So if we can try and get through these, that would be really helpful, and perhaps more succinct questions than answers. I'm going to come to Tess and then Sandesh.
Thank you, Convener. Over the festive period, NHS Grampian put out an extraordinary plea on social media for exhausted NHS staff to come in on their days off. Dr. Ian Kennedy, chairman of the BMA, as you know, actually said that this intervention should close any debate that that the NHS is broken. And it's well publicised how strapped for staff NHS Grampian is. So does the Cabinet Secretary think it's going to happen more often? And is it acceptable that this becomes the norm?
No, it's definitely not the norm, and shouldn't ever be the norm. In Tess White's own articulation of her question, she referenced that you know, this was an extreme measure taken by NHS Grampian. I would never want to see that as being the norm. And I think, you know, objectively, if we all take a step back, we can agree that that period, or the festive period in particular, those few weeks running up to Christmas, the Christmas period, and then, you know, first week of January in particular, were probably probably the most difficult the NHS has ever faced, actually, and it's certainly the course of the pandemic, and I would argue possibly even in its entire existence. So really, you know, difficult choices, including the pausing of elective care. We've already mentioned, I don't want to see that happen because of the constituents that write to me and to Tess White and to everybody around this table who are suffering because of a last-minute cancellation on an operation, again, that they've already been waiting for a year plus. So we don't want extreme measures. And on the workforce, she's right. The workforce is exhausted. I'm not going to argue with Tess White on that. I speak to many of those on the front line, and they tell me about that exhaustion. So I'm very grateful for all that they do, and the fact that many of them responded to that particular call. But I would be, I wouldn't just be aghast if that was the norm. I wouldn't allow that to become the norm. So an extremist measure, which I would hope we wouldn't have to repeat again. But it's so important that local health boards are just given that flexibility to make those really difficult decisions.
Sandesh.
Thank you. Scottish Conservatives, through an FOI, discovered people waiting a long time for diagnostic tests. And why is that relevant to rural areas? Well, NHS Grampian, there was a 5-year wait. NHS Tayside saw a 4-year wait. So my question is, why is there such a bottleneck in radiology and diagnostic testing, which we know has been the case for a long time? What have you done about it, and what are you doing about it?
It's a really good question, because clearly a delay in diagnostics has an impact on an individual, can have the potential to have a real impact on an individual's health outcomes. So none of us want to see any delay in diagnostics. Dr. Gregor Smith and I were involved in the press briefing yesterday, and the issue of diagnostics came up on the back of that FOI and relevant articles. And a couple of things, or a few things, I would say. One is that the obvious impact the pandemic has had, that's not unique to Scotland. That is a situation replicated, I would say, not just right across the UK, but right across the world. People had to make exceptionally difficult decisions, and we already spoke, didn't we, Dr. Smith, about the difficult decisions in elective care. I don't think I'd be over-egging it to say that one of the most, if not the most difficult decision taken during the pandemic, certainly was the pausing of screening, cancer screening, for a very brief period. But, even a single day of pausing screening can have an impact, let alone for the months that we had to do that in the early days of the pandemic, and never taken lightly. But because of decisions like that, because of the pandemic, the impacts it had on our health service, that's why we see the scale. Now, that's a scale of backlog. I'm not here to suggest that there wasn't any delays in diagnostic testing pre-pandemic, but I think anybody's, again, objective observation of the figures, the level of delay, would show you that there's been an impact, significant impact in the pandemic. I noticed that FOI and the resultant information that came from it, that there was a few people, unfortunately, waiting far, far too long. I'll go back, I suppose, to what the First Minister said in this regard yesterday, which is, well, first of all, nobody should be waiting, certainly as long as 5 years, I think, was one of the cases that was quoted. That, to me, is an absolute anomaly. And we've got to understand why that happens in individual cases, because even if it is just one case or two cases or a few cases where that is happening, then that's having an impact on the individual involved. So we've got to understand why. But that is not the norm, that length of wait. What are you doing about it? So we've funded additional, and this is really relevant for remote and rural Scotland. We've invested in mobile MRI and mobile CT scanners, I think 6 MRI and 5 CT scanners, but I'll double check the detail of that. And through the investments that we've made thus far, that's provided some additional capacity. What I've done is also looking at the winter pressures that we've clearly faced and facing. I've put an additional 1.5 million towards diagnostics and radiology in particular. Again, from memory, between January and the end of March, that will give us in the order, I'll correct the record if I'm wrong, but in the order of around 15,000 additional scans. But I'll just double check that, and if I'm way off the figures, I'll come back through convener. But I think it was around about 15,000. So we'll keep investing and try to increase the capacity where we can of diagnostics.
Thank you. We really do need to move on. We are very short of time. Can I take David Torrance and then Carol Mockin?
Thank you, convener. Cabinet Secretary, a friend of mine had a position in NHS Highland to go to, and after 3 months of searching, could not find suitable accommodation. And somebody who has strong connections to Avi Moore, the residents there really welcome the new community hospital. But once again, there is no accommodation there to get unless you want to pay £600 a week for a holiday let.
Yeah.
And in your opening statement, Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned that the Highlands and Islands University had increased its places by 33%. Will we not lose them from these areas if there is no accommodation? So do you think that affordable accommodation is the biggest barrier to recruitment and retention of staff? And how can we fix that, Cabinet Secretary?
Yeah, so first and foremost, there's just no doubting that housing is an important part of this. I hear from many people who wanted to or tried to take up a rural, remote or island post, but it was housing that ultimately was the reason why they couldn't. Or sometimes, in some cases, it may well be education, but tends to be housing. So to give, if I can, because I understand brevity is important here, there is a relentless cross-government focus on this. And I'll meet with colleagues who've got responsibility, obviously, for affordable housing. And together we're developing, as the member probably knows, a remote and rural and island housing action plan to meet the housing needs of those communities, which is a real focus on retention as well as attracting people to those communities. So I think it's probably just fair to say that where innovative solutions can be found locally, absolutely, and I can see that happening in parts of Scotland where accommodation is being repurposed for this and for this reason, but it's got to take a cross government approach, and that's why the remote rural and island housing action plan is so important.
Thank you. I'm conscious that I have about three colleagues who are looking to ask questions. Is the Cabinet Secretary content in terms of time, given that we have subsequent business?
Yes, I mean, I do have topical and other such things, but yes, sure. And okay. Debate. But
we will certainly work to make that work. Can I take Carol Mockin, who will be followed by Stephanie Callaghan, and then I'll take Emma Harper in our last question in that order. So we'll start with Carol.
Thank you. My question is on workforce training, which is quite a wide subject, and perhaps I understand that we won't be able to answer all, but I'm very interested to know if there has been a lot of work done in NHS Education Scotland around rural training, clinical places in particular, and I'm very interested in the notion about those local places, because I do believe there is sufficient evidence to suggest if we can train people locally, if we can get people into these areas, these are really interesting jobs and we can retain some staff. There's a wider issue around the different professions, EHPs, nurses, but I'm very interested to know what engagement you've had with Education Scotland.
Yeah, so first of all, there's no doubt in what Karen Mockin says that the feedback overwhelmingly would suggest that if you're able to train people locally, then there's a better chance of retention and retaining them locally where we can. And again, I will not rehearse what's been said already around the Scott Gym programme, around the fact that actually our GP fill rate for those in the north of Scotland is exceptionally good, and I've already referenced some of the at-distance learning that we're able to provide for the short and midwifery course, so we're able to keep people in locality while they study to train to become midwives within that shortened programme. So there's a lot we're doing in that space. I've certainly said to health boards that they should be as innovative as they possibly can be. For the additional training posts that we've made available in relation to the medical workforce, again, we're looking to see how many of those training places we can ensure are filled by remote and rural and island health boards as well. So I think, again, for the sake of brevity, it's worth me saying there's no doubting the premise of Karen Mockin's question. And secondly, there's a fair bit of work going into making sure we make training places for whether that's nursing, midwifery, GP, medical workforce, making sure we have as many of those training places in remote, rural and island Scotland. But so Lewis, I know we're tight for time, but I think so Lewis probably has a fair bit of expertise.
Yes, NES is in particular is doing good things in specific training programmes, including rural fellows. The ambitions beyond that, clearly in terms of the multidisciplinary team and also in the direction of social care as well, which I think is essential for an integrated approach to the care of the people of Scotland going forward. So there are many good things going on in remote and rural right now. I'm hoping that the National Centre will amplify that, and indeed NES's role in that will be very prominent.
Yeah.
I come to Stephanie Callaghan now, question on Scott Gym.
Thank you, Convener. Already, Dr Smith, you brought up Scott Gym earlier on there, and it was great to hear you talking about how it galvanised the career of some of the trainers that you'd spoken about, and also made me think back as well, Sir Richie, to your comments around Rediscover the Joy and the success of that campaign there. And I think we're incredibly lucky in Scotland to live in such a beautiful, amazing country, and not least our rural areas. And I'm wondering, it's obviously a very, very... It can be very attractive for students, and I'm wondering if there are opportunities to further develop Scott Gym or to extend that to undergraduate models as well. So what opportunities and perhaps what challenges would there be around that? Thanks.
Yeah, I'll let Dr Smith go in just a second. He's been so integral to the programme.
So we have actually grown the intake actually already in terms of the Scottish GEM programme. What I would say, we often get calls for other health boards that are not part of the Scottish GEM programme. Can we have them involved? And in fact, the convener is one of those advocates for expansion of that particular programme. I think it's so important that now we've had the first cohort of graduates, we just ensure that the programme is stabilised before we consider additional expansion in terms of additional health boards or anything further that we do in terms of, for example, at the moment, you're right, it's a graduate entry programme, making that an undergraduate. I think that would be challenging and quite disruptive to a model that is we're trying to stabilise. It's hugely popular, I should say, and I think we should absolutely be open-minded to potential expansion in the future. My own view is at the moment, it should it stabilise, ensure we're getting the benefit from that programme. But again, I'll maybe pass to Dr. Smith with the conveners, if he's OK to do that, then I'll pass to Dr. Smith. You might want to add some more.
Dr. Smith?
Yes, yeah, so very briefly, we're obviously seeing some expansion this year in terms of the places offered in ScotGem. I think that's a positive thing. I think we've got to be careful that we don't grow it too quickly and overwhelm particularly the opportunities for training and then dilute the training experience that people get through it. I think that's a really important aspect of it. But certainly in the time that I've spent with some of the students as they're going through that programme, I was lucky enough to provide a lecture for them a couple of months ago. And what I'm seeing is very enthusiastic and insightful learners who are really keen to get out there, who understand the challenges that exist within the system just now, and are not short of ideas as to how they'll go about trying to contribute to kind of facing those challenges as well. A very positive experience to be, as I say, to be anywhere near around that programme just now, but it's one that we need to make sure we grow in time in a proportionate way that we don't dilute the content.
Briefly, finally, Emma Harper.
Quick education and skills question. The mobile skills unit was developed and in order to deliver education more rurally, and I know that the big lorry-sized van does simulated training for like chest tube insertion or even intraosseous needles insertion, things like that. So I know it's been all over Scotland, and is there an opportunity to maybe focus more on that kind of remote and rural education delivery using the managed skills network or the clinical skills network to do that?
Yeah, I think it would be very brief to just say yes. I mean, any potential to use digital, to use mobile technology or indeed mobile equipment to do that. I myself have seen fantastic examples of simulators within our training facilities, and incredible just how real life it feels. I have to say, somebody who's a non-clinician being in there, I can even feel my heart rate racing as those who were training were dealing with a medical emergency in that simulated environment. So yes, in short, we are exploring that and seeing what further we can do in that respect.
Thank you very much. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his attendance and his indulgence in terms of going over the time allotted, and to his officials as well for their attendance. Can I suggest to the committee that the evidence we've heard this morning, we actually consider our next steps on these petitions at a further meeting? Are members agreed? Thank you. We'll have a short comfort break.
Are we okay?
Ready? Okay, can I just call colleagues back to order? Our third item is consideration of an affirmative instrument, which is the Dentists, Dental Care Professionals, Nurses, Nursing Associates and Midwives International Registrations Order 2022. The purpose of this instrument is to amend the legislative framework underpinning regulators' international registration routes. In particular, the instrument enables the General Dental Council to set out and change its processes for international registration more efficiently. This includes providing updated powers for the General Dental Council to charge for services it undertakes, and it allows the Nursing and Midwifery Council to allow the more flexibility in the range of international testing routes to ascertain applicants' competence and change rules which set out registration processes to reduce the time taken to process international applications. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 13th of December 2022 and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. We will now have an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care and supporting officials on the instrument. Once we have had all questions answered, we will proceed to a formal debate on the motion. And I welcome again to the committee Humza Yousaf, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care, and accompanying the Cabinet Secretary, Rachel Coutts, Solicitor, Primary Care, Medicines and Treatments Branch, and Rebecca Wright, Senior Policy Manager, Regulation of Health Professions, Chief Nursing Officers Directorate in the Scottish Government. Thank you for joining us today, and I will invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. Long time no speak, but I'm very keen to take any questions the committee may have. As you've already heard from the last session that we have just concluded, that of course it's so important that our health service is able to meet the challenges, the intense challenges that we're currently under, and meeting those as they arise. And this order, I think, gives additional flexibility to the GDC, the NMC, to help the health service to respond to some of those challenges. Since the end of 2020, committee members will be aware, no doubt, European law relating to the recognition of qualified healthcare professionals from the European Economic Area no longer applies in the UK. Current standstill arrangements mean that the UK professional healthcare regulators have continued to automatically recognise EEA and Swiss obtained qualifications for up to 2 years after the end of the transition period. The period of automatic recognition ends in early 2023, when the Secretary for State for Health and Social Care will review the approach to registering European Economic Area qualified professionals. The order is being made under Section 60 of the Health Act 1999 and will amend the Dentist Act 1984, the Nursing and Midwifery Order 2001 and other subordinate legislation. The order will change the legislative frameworks of the GDC and the NMC to allow them to amend the registration processes for international applicants. Currently, both the General Dental Council and the Nursing and Midwifery Council's governing legislation prevents them making changes to their registration processes. In the case of the GDC, the current legislative structure makes it quite difficult, quite time-consuming to make changes to its registration process, and likewise the NMC must follow an overly detailed procedure to carry out assessments for international applicants. The order makes a number of changes to the legislative frameworks of the NMC and the GDC's international registration requirements. First, it allows the GDC to apply a range of assessment options to determine whether applicants have the right knowledge, the right skills, the right experience to practice in the UK. Secondly, it removes the requirement for dental authorities to use an assessment for overseas applicants, such as the Overseas Registration Exam, known as the OR. Third, it allows the GDC to charge fees to international institutions for expenses incurred in relation to international registration, so it can cover the costs of recognising international qualifications which meet UK standards. Fourthly, the GDC will be able to make rules setting out the details of its international registration processes without the need for Privy Council approval, so that change can be made far more efficiently. Fifth, a transitional period for the OR, the Overseas Registration Examination, will continue to apply for 12 months after this order comes into force, at which point the GDC will publish new rules for its international registration process. process is subject to, of course, parliamentary approval. The effect of the order is to allow the GDC to use increased flexibility to set out two international registration routes based on an assessment of an application's qualifications, their skills or training, and completion of an OAR style assessment, and the recognition of an applicant's qualifications where the GDC has assessed that qualification and consider that it provides applicants with the required knowledge, the required skills and the required experience. In terms of changes to the NMC, to the Nursing and Midwifery Order, the NMC will continue to apply its test of competence as the main assessment route for international applicants, which will remain in the legislation as one of the ways the NMC can make sure an applicant meets its standards. But the order will bring in other pathways for registration. Firstly, recognition of an NMC-approved programme of education from outside of the UK. Secondly, in limited situations, a qualification comparability exercise, which the NMC will then use to judge whether the applicant's qualification is of a comparable standard to an NMC-approved UK qualification. In either situation, applicants would still need to meet the NMC's other registration requirements, such as English language, indemnity and payment, of course, of the registration fee. In conclusion, Convener, I fully support the instrument as a pragmatic solution. It will improve consistency and give these regulators much needed flexibility in responding to the changing circumstances, and obviously happy to answer any questions that members may have.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I invite any questions for the Cabinet Secretary? Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. It's just a quick question, really, Cabinet Secretary. It seems reasonable that this order is providing the GDC and the NMC greater flexibility to amend their existing international registration pathway. So I know there's challenges with dentistry, especially in my region, in Dumfries and Galloway, for access to NHS dentists. So will this ultimately help us with recruitment for dentists and dental practitioners, especially as a result or a consequence of Brexit?
I certainly hope so. Certainly would hope so. Because when I've spoken to both the NMC and the GDC in my time as Health Secretary, and they are as excited as regulators tend to get, but they were excited about the fact that the additional flexibility really could assist with that international recruitment. I'll not go into the challenges of Brexit and that Brexit has brought in relation to both health and social care. I think that's well rehearsed, but this flexibility absolutely can help with that. And as per the previous evidence session, there's no doubt the health boards are wanting to make maximum advantage and use of international recruitment. Not the panacea, I'm always quite keen to say that, but it can provide an additionality, a significant additionality, and there's no doubt that these additional flexibilities in the way that I've outlined in my opening remarks could absolutely help with that, both in terms of the dental workforce and indeed the nursing midwifery workforce too.
Okay, thank you.
Are there any further questions? Can we move then to agenda item 4, which is the formal debate on the affirmative instrument, on which we have just taken the Cabinet Secretary's evidence. Can I remind committee that members should not put questions to the Cabinet Secretary during the formal debate, and officials may not speak in the debate. Cabinet Secretary, before I invite you to move it, is there anything further you wish to say in relation to the motion?
Nothing further.
Thank you very much. Can I invite any contributions to the debate? Okay, it is my intention then to ask the Cabinet Secretary to formally move motion S6M07061 in your name.
Formally moved, Convener.
Thank you. The question is that motion S6M07061 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary be approved. Are we all agreed? The committee is therefore agreed. Thank you. That concludes consideration of the instrument. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his time this morning and indeed for his officials for attending also.
Thank you.
At our next meeting, we will be taking evidence from Cricket Scotland and Sports Scotland to get an update on their response to the independent review of racism in Scottish cricket. We will then take evidence from representatives of Food Standards Scotland, and that concludes the public part of our meeting today.